Sing?
Yes.
Yes.
Perfect. Okay. All right. So this is pretty much what I cover, which is the data science method have been hugely successful in commercial domain, could be very promising for scientific discovery, but lots of disappointment in many, many domains. And the question is, why do these methods perform so well in scientific problems? And there are a number of issues there. And one of them is that these problems happen to be often under constraint. We have a huge data set in scientific problems, and ISU is no exception. But oftentimes, from the perspective of data science, we may be in a situation where we have lots of variables, but small number of samples. Like the climate data, we may have only, we have so much data for the entire world at different resolutions, and yet the number of years for which the data is available is a good quality data is available on a wall-to-wall coverage. Could be as little as just 40, 50 years or no more than 100 years. And if each year is sort of taken as an independent sample, then you have very small number of samples to build a predictive model. And many of the methods that we have built in data science and machine learning really rely upon very large number of samples. So for example, a lot of the successes you see with deep learning is in many cases is dependent upon a huge number of samples. The other is that the standard method for assessing and ensuring generalizability of the machine learning models tend to break down in a situation where you have small number of samples and large number of variables. And what is worse is that you can learn spurious relationship that look deceptively good on training and test data set using the standard cross-validation methods, which means that it's one thing for you not to get good models, but it's even worse to get models that look good but actually are not very good at all, which is exactly what happened with Google FluTrend. And again, that happens because of the small sample size. And the third thing is the interpretability, which is not necessarily a major focus in machine learning. The performance is a major goal. That is, you want to be able to do better. You want to build a better predictability as opposed to necessarily having higher interpretability. But in science, interpretability is an important end goal for a number of reasons. One of them is that interpretability is what allows you to create the scientific advancement small step at a time. So you can build on previous steps. And if you don't understand what you have done, you can really build up on top of it. The other reason interpretability is extremely important is to be able to ensure that you don't have the situation in which you have a model that looks good, but it's actually not really good. Which is why in a lot of these domains, especially like biomedical domains and many other domains, scientific domains, people wouldn't accept, wouldn't take the model's results seriously unless they can go down to the physical interpretation and then figure out the connection between a physical interpretation and the model output. So all of these things sort of make it, are some of the reasons that the machine learning models tend to fail, and Google FluTrend, for example, would sort of fit into this category as well. So if you look at the approaches for being able to use data science method in many of the scientific problems, where we are trying to learn a relationship between physical variables, between a different set of physical variables, oftentimes people would use these standard equations that are like mass conservation I guess we don't have any sort of slide, that's fine. The standard set of equations like mass conservation, energy conservation, and use them to sort of build a relationship between input and output. And if all of those physical relationships are very well known and all the parameters are well understood, then all you would need is either a closed form solution or perhaps a computation simulation to sort of map the input to the output. But in, there are certain situations when you have knowledge gaps in describing certain processes. So for example, you're trying to build a hydrological model. You're trying to figure out, depending on the rainfall, how much is the runoff in different streams, or how much of the contaminants are being are flowing in different streams and so forth. And in those cases, you have to sort of build a model of as the water falls from the sky, how much of it is being reflected back, how much is being absorbed, how much is being picked up by the trees, how much is flowing underneath the ground. And if you have a good way of capturing all of these relationships, you can capture them in the two model and learn the parameters from a few samples that you have. But because of the gaps in describing these processes and unavailability of these parameters, these models tend to not do as well as they should do. Now, in contrast, the data science models, which basically depend upon a large number of representative samples, and a good example there would be, let's say, language translation. So if you want to translate a sentence of one language to the other, you have a choice of taking the sentence and using a linguistic theory, come up with a meaning, and then once you have a meaning, then you can take it from one language to the other by using a generative model. Instead of that, which would be more like a theory-based model, the other approach would be to sort of see the connections between relationship between the sentences in different different languages. And language translation has been sort of, people have been working on it for 40, 50 years. And back in 70s and 80s, there was a huge interest in this area and they were not making a lot of progress. And then about 12 years ago, there was a million sentence corpus built by Brown University called Brown Corpus that advanced the sort of VR quite a bit. But about 10 years ago, Google built a billion, a trillion sentence corpus. And this billion sentence corpus built, by Brown University was very handcrafted, but this trillion sentence corpus built by Google was actually just built from the information available on the web. And once that got into place, then people were able to build translation models that are much, much better than anything that you could build using linguistic theories, and they do far, far better. So the question is, so this is sort of the dichotomy that we are sort of trying to figure out. That is, if the theory-based models are good, then you have a good understanding of the theory, and then but if there are gaps, then you got to go out. And data science models are really good when you have lots of data, and then you can use it to learn the relationships. But it turns out, as you saw earlier slide, that in the physical problems and in the physical situation, we don't have a lot of samples. And in data science models, where you are able to learn without knowledge of the domain, but you need a lot of samples. So there's a new paradigm that sort of is emerging, which we sort of call theory-guided data science, in which you are trying to take full advantage of the data science machinery that has been built over the last several decades, but without ignoring the treasure of accumulated knowledge in scientific domains, which can be potentially very helpful in sort of closing the gap here. Now, just to sort of see as to how this gap potentially could be filled using these, before that, let me sort of mention that this is sort of something we have been pursuing, but the same idea is being pursued in many, many domains by a lot of different people. So in climate science, of course, the VBS is sort of working on it for several years. But you see this paper in fluid dynamics just from this last year in 2016, which literally says the same thing, machine learning augmented predictive modeling of turbulent separated fluid flow over airfall. And I'm towards the end, I'm hoping to give you an example from this piece of work to show as to how these people were able to bring in physics and data science models together to advance, to basically do a better job. There's a work in material science, and again, this is the title of their paper, Finding Nature's Missing Ternary Oxide Components Using Machine Learning and Density Function Theory. And I'll give you an example of that as to how they're bringing in data science and machine and scientific knowledge together. And then the example sort of goes on in many, many different domains. So if you sort of see as to how the physics or the information about the domain can be brought to bear to improve the data science model, first, let us sort of see how these data science models really work in practice. If you look at the history of building these predictive models for the last several decades, people would sort of look at a training data set of input and output pairs, and will come up with some models like a decision tree or a support vector machine or a neural network or anything like this. And it's very well known that these models can become, as you're given a training set, you can build models of arbitrarily high complexity. And as you make these models more and more complex, you can get very good accuracy on the training data set. but that's not what you're interested in. You're usually interested in the accuracy on the generalization on the unseen data set. So that's sort of captured here in this picture here. That is, you have in any given framework, you have models of different level of complexity, like a decision tree. M1 would be a decision tree with few number of nodes, and M3 would be a decision tree with large number of nodes. And if you're trying to get to a truth, which is represented by star, and you don't see the truth, you only have a sample, which could be a reflection of the truth, but not exactly the truth. And then you can use this model to try to get as close to the truth as possible. And if you have a more complex model, it'll get closer to the truth. But on the other hand, the because the truth is not visible to you explicitly, you can have a huge variance as to where you capture the truth. So basically, the samples that you have could be representing the truth anywhere. And then, so you have a model, M3 could give you a model which is on the average very close to the truth, but very, very high variance from the truth. So they have a very high variance, but low bias. And if a very simple model, it could be very far away from the truth, so it has very high bias, but a small variance. So this is this standard bias variance trade-off that people talk about in machine learning and statistics. And we capture that in traditional data science modeling by saying that instead of looking for performance on the sample itself, I'm going to look for generalization performance, which would look for the accuracy on the sample and the simplicity, and it'll try to balance them out. That is, you try to make sure that you prefer a simpler model, even if it's less accurate on the data that you have. Now, this is the traditional machinery that is used, and it's behind nearly every machine learning algorithm. That is, you try to come up with this bias variance trade-off. And it turns out that if you have some scientific knowledge about the domain, then you can really bring this to bear within this format by simply pruning the space of models by using scientific knowledge. That is, a whole bunch of the space would not be consistent with physics or with the domain information. And if you eliminate them, then you have a much easier time dealing with this bias variance trade-off. So in some sense, you're trying to optimize generalization performance, which is proportional to both all three things. You're trying to optimize accuracy, the model simplicity, and you're also trying to optimize consistency with the physical understanding. And it turns out that this machinery can be brought to bear in many, many different ways. And then there's this paper that I mentioned to you earlier, basically gives five different ways of talking about bringing in theory into machine learning, or the scientific theory into machine learning. The paper is very long, it goes into detail. I'm just going to go into each of these very, very quickly. So the first approach is in which you are trying to use, you're sort of trying to control the search process of the space by using constraint optimization or regularization procedures. And many people have tried these methods in different domains, in chemistry, in biomedicine, in climate. We have done some work in this area, in genomics, and then come up with some very interesting results. And a lot of this is very, very recent. The other direction is being able to build the structure of the model, like the structure of the neural network, or a choice of a response function or a loss function. And examples of neuroscience that people have developed in this area. There's a lot of work on being able to build a model and looking at the output of the model and making sure that it's consistent with the physical information. So there's a you build a predictive model, and then you prune certain solutions by doing post-processing and making them consistent with physics. And then 4 and 5 actually are going to the guts of the physical model itself and bringing machine learning down to it. So I will try to give very quickly in a minute or so example of each one of them just to give you flavor. But again, the paper has a lot more detail. So this is the theory guided learning, in which I'm starting with the standard application of training samples. So let's assume that I'm trying to learn the build a model for land pixels and water pixels on the globe using the multispectral data. And let's say somebody gave me some sample data, and the sample data happens to the squares are represented by water, or water is represented by square, and then land is represented by circles. So if you look at this picture, you have, you know, it's being represented in two features, feature one and feature two. And if you're given the squares and the circles, you are going to come up with the traditional boundary, which is this one, the vertical line, which actually is not very accurate. But if you also happen to have information about the elevation of these pixels, which is represented in these shaded boundary here, then it turns out that by adding that constraint, you can make an elevation-aware boundary, which would be slanted, and which would be much better results. And again, there are ways you can have these kind of constraints incorporated into your optimization machinery for the machine learning algorithm, and then you can make your predictive model consistent with physics and thus get better results. The model number two, the theme number two is being able to use the physical knowledge into the design of the model. And this is actually a very interesting piece of work, not by our group, but just very recently published last year for face recognition using neural networks. And it turns out that if you take these neural networks and you keep them in the domain independent way, then you have some results that are not very physically interpretable. But if you build these neural networks in a biological, plausible sense, and one of the heuristics that they use in this paper is that neurons that fire together, they wire together. This is a sentence from their paper, which effectively says that if two of these units here in the thin layer sort of tend to turn on at the same time, then they should be connected to the same set of output layers at the same time. So that apparently, by putting that constraint, they were able to come up with much better and much more physically relevant results than otherwise. And then the research team number three is being able to prune the output of the predictive model. I'm not going to go into much detail, but these people from material science, and there's a more recent work in 2013 in which they sort of build these, they use DFT methods to check material properties, and they were able to prune the output of machine learning models and then come up with very predictive results. I'll conclude with this last research theme to give you a little sense of how in a physics-based model you can bring in, we can sort of augment them using machine learning approaches. So a theory-based dynamical system that is used very, very commonly in many scientific domains, including hydrology and climate science, fluid dynamics. What we have is a situation where you have a whole bunch of variables that are observable. There are a whole bunch of variables that you're trying to predict, which are y. And then you have a system has a state, and basically using the x and z, you can predict the value of y. You can compute the value of y using x and z, using physical equations like mass conservation, energy conservation. And then basically you're computing these variables at different times, at time t plus one and so forth. And these variables are also being computed, not just in time, but also in space. Usually there's a physical domain that's associated with them. And as I said earlier, if these equations are very well known, the only thing that you're trying to learn are the parameters, and those parameters then can be calibrated using training data, very much like they're done in a machine learning paradigm. And the problem happens in these dynamical systems when you don't have, when some of the physics is not properly understood, or if there are so many parameters that you don't have enough samples to be able to calibrate the models for the right value of parameters. So what people are beginning to do is take these dynamical systems, theory-based dynamical systems, and augment them using data models. So there's a caricature on the right side is called the hybrid physics data models. We call it HPD models. And the idea is that you're trying to go from X, which is the observation, to the Y. And traditional approach is to go through the theory-based models. An alternate approach would be to just simply use a data science model, which is use the combination of X and Y, and build a mapping between them using neural networks, support vector machine, and anything like that. Now, we know that the lower approach will not work by itself because we don't have enough samples. We know that the upper approach does not work very well because we don't have enough physics. We know some physics, but not all of it. and you have too many parameters to learn. And what people are beginning to do is try to figure out how do you combine them together. And there are many, many different ways we can combine them together. And one of the ways that I'm going to show you in the next slide is from some work by people at University of Michigan, in which they took a giant equation of the theory-based model and replaced a piece of it using machine learning model. And I think I'm just going to show you the result here, which is they're sort of trying to do turbulence modeling of an airflow on an airfoil, and they're trying to predict the lift, which is the on this given the angle of attack. So the angle of attack is this alpha, and the lift is what they're trying to predict. And what they're trying to show here is that they use a standard, state-of-the-art physics-based model. You get this green line. If you have the, if you look at the observation for this data, you have the blue line. The experiments are the blue line. The physics-based model, pure physics-based model, gives you the green line. They don't have results for the pure data science model. It will actually do absolutely horrible. They didn't even bother to do it. But the but the hybrid model, which is the red line, you can see that it almost matches the blue line. And then shows the power of bringing in physics and data together. I think I'm running out of time, so I'm going to stop here and take any questions if there are. Questions?
I have a question.
Amy, yes.
I have two questions. My first question is, can't we have a working group on this?
Sure, I think it'd be a great idea to have a working group. Yes, yeah, yeah.
Great. And then my other question is, how does the field of system identification fall into all this?
Could you repeat it again?
So there's this field of system identification, which is kind of learning, trying to learn physical models from data or identifying a system. And it's usually very much down to earth, where you kind of assume some kind of a function, linear or whatever, and then you try to match it from data to identify what your engineering system or biological system is. I'm just wondering.
Would you say that that's similar to the model calibration problem? Because I've heard people talk about model calibration in exactly the same way.
Yeah, it goes in the direction. It has a little bit more freedom than that, I would say.
I see. Okay. Yes, yeah. So I think the model calibration, basically, as I said, the traditional approach is you're going from X to Y through your modeling approach, and traditionally, they're just looking for learning the parameters, but what you're seeing is you're willing to even change some of the pieces inside the model. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Am I understanding it correctly?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So I think this caricature sort of tries to capture the same thing. That is, if I'm trying to build a system given some input and output combinations using the pure data science approaches, then I'm throwing away all of the scientific knowledge that exists.
Right.
And then probably I won't get a very good model. And actually, in most cases, I won't get a very good model. But if I can somehow bring pieces of them together, I could do better.
Yeah.
Well, I think there's a room for discussion there. Or maybe we should talk definitely offline and then and bring anybody else into the loop on that one.
I would love to see a working group. This is so exciting. We should have activities on that. We should try to get more people to think this way and see how they fit into this whole puzzle.
Thank you, May. And I still remember, Suzanne, you and Yolanda had this workshop about a couple of years ago, the very first workshop. And that's when I found out a whole bunch of other people were thinking about the same topic. We were sort of thinking about it for a long time, but at the workshop that you invited, there was many people were talking about very similar issues. So that was really comforting for us to know that, yes, this is a direction that's very promising.
I remember some of those conversations and the enthusiasm and excitement in that moment of discovery that happened at that workshop, which was really neat. I agree with Ime, this is fascinating, and it would be fantastic if we could find a way to get people together so that we can talk about it and ask questions and put our brains together and think about ways that we can apply it and test it. Vipin, thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you. And actually, let me also introduce Anuj, who's also sitting here. He's the main person who actually put this paper together, even though we have been working on it for a long time.
That's fantastic. Are there any other questions while we've got everybody on the line?
I have a question for you in terms of you know, in my group, we work a lot with ontologies that have constraints. So the kind of knowledge that we could bring to bear is really very much in terms of this object has these properties, it can only have two of these particular property, or this is the range between the values of the variables, or you know, definitional properties of objects. So if we have this kind of ontological constraints defined, what would be the process to include these constraints into one of these machine learning frameworks, you think?
Okay, so I think there are two approaches, of the two approaches that I talked about in this presentation. Both of them can use some of these constraints. One of them was the optimization approach, in which you rule out certain solutions because they don't follow your constraint. And the other one was that you, once you find the solution, you check whether they match the constraints, and if not, then you discard them. Like the material science, yeah, they have very few samples, so they can come up with lots of relationships, but once they prune them, the uninteresting ones, then they find something good. So I think the knowledge that you have in terms of constraints can be used in at least two different ways. I'm sure there are others. Okay. But there are two that I can think of for which we have the examples.
Okay. So you're iterating between basically finding candidate solutions and then pruning after you've got a subset of candidate solutions for the good matches.
Right. So there is one approach that we have used ourselves, and then people in computational chemistry have also used successfully independently, in which they use the predictive model to come up with the input-output relationship. So given an input, they will construct output, but some of them will not be accurate. And then they make them consistent with the physical knowledge by doing refinement. Nice. And we have used that machinery to be able to build a map for the water dynamics on the entire globe, just using that paradigm.
Nice.
And then these people that I refer to in my slide, they applied the same similar principle in computational chemistry to predict properties of materials.
That's really exciting stuff. Really, really interesting. Well, let's see. I think that we've run through everything that was on the agenda. We will have our next meeting will happen on April 4th, and we will follow up with emails and try to connect with people a bit more directly so that we can start to get people engaged with the working groups. Yolanda or Ime or anyone else, are there any other comments or thoughts before we wrap up this telecon? No.
You covered it all.
Thank you, everyone. Vipin, amazing. Thank you so much for that presentation. What a great idea to have these presentations. It really adds, in my opinion, a richness to these calls that you don't usually get. So thanks everybody for staying and listening to the entire conversation and the presentation in particular.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Everybody take care.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye,
everyone.
Bye-bye. Bye.